and welcome to this very special discussion with Sir James Mitchell. Sir James is one of the foremost leaders in the Caribbean, having served his country, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, for more than 17 years as Prime Minister, and he's here in Grenada on a mission and has kindly consented to take some time to speak with us. Sir James, a warm welcome to the Spice Isle. Very, very glad to have you in our midst again.
Thank you very much for having me on this rainy day. I'm delighted that Grenada is getting some rain, and I hope we're getting some at home in the island.
Yes, just yesterday I was traveling through and I looked around and I said, it looks like we're heading for another drought.
We certainly can't afford a drought.
Cannot afford it at all. Sir James, as I said, you are here on a mission. We will not be talking about why you're here in Grenada, but I'd love to get your perspective on the current state of the politics in Grenada. Right now, we have a government that controls the minority in the lower house of parliament, having dismissed 10 members of the party recently, five of whom are sitting MPs. Have you ever seen such an action in any government in the Caribbean before?
It is unprecedented in the Caribbean and probably unprecedented in any country that functions as a democratic country. And it is really pathetic. Grenada, unfortunately, has a history of this kind of chaos. I remember after we had created the new National Party and Herbert Blaise had become Prime Minister, the morning in Karakou, I chatted with him bright and early after breakfast. I said, Herbert, how are you going to structure your government? When I heard how he was going to allocate portfolios and with his frail health was going to hold on to so many portfolios, I saw disaster. Even I called my colleague John Compton in Miami and I said, please give Blaise a call before he goes to Grenada and creates incipient confusion. And then they had it again with Cord and Bishop. And now another set of confusion in Grenada. It is really sad. And I think it is undignified of a prime minister to be hanging on in those circumstances. I once had a motion of no confidence filed against me when two members of my government crossed the floor, is when we were an alliance and when the time I was a premier. I allowed the parliament to function, let the monk parliament meet, and I was very anxious to go to the parliament to put on record all that I had done for the country. And before the opposition started to debate, I said, Mr. Speaker, I have news for you. The Governor General has already dissolved this parliament.
And that worked in your favor?
No, it did not. But nevertheless, it worked in my favor to establish myself as a Democrat.
Definitely. And that is exactly where I was leading. It works in your favor because it shows you're willing to stand up and deal with the issue rather than to try and hide away from it.
Hide.
Yeah. So, if you were to speak with the Prime Minister, with Prime Minister Thomas, what would be your advice to him under the circumstances?
You mean in the past?
No, today.
Today? I would say to him, Hillman, I've known him, you know. He attended my book launch when I launched my book, Beyond the Islands in Grenada, so we on talking terms, and when I dealt with investors in Grenada, we are the same reception and so on. So I know Tillman from a long time. And Tillman is appreciative of me because when he is in jail, I was the first voice in the Caribbean calling for intervention and rescuing Grenada. And they're in jail and they heard me on the radio, you know. Now, so we aren't speaking terms. I would say to him, Tillman, you have embarrassed yourself by staying away from Parliament so long. I don't expect you to go there like that. You should be a man and go to the Governor General and tell him the Parliament is dissolved. And you have 90 days within which to have elections. You still have some freedom of choice of the 90 days. And you yourself have restricted yourself to that particular position. So deal with it and try and redeem your name in history.
So that would be the course to take. But looking at it from a constitutional perspective, he now controls the minority, 6 of 15 members in the House of Parliament. Would you say that is an aberration? And as a member of the population of the Caribbean, how does that impact on you?
It doesn't impact on me, in so except that what impacts on Grenada affects the climate and the image of the Caribbean. That is what concerns me.
And I know you are someone who is very strong in regional development and having the entire Caribbean go forward as one region. So do you say that this will cause some sort of, well, it has set a precedent. There are other prime ministers in the region we know who are very, very passionate about being prime minister. Do you see this really leading the Caribbean in a direction that we should not be going 50 years after independence?
I wouldn't say that about prime ministers. I said there are 3 kinds of politicians in my analysis. They're the politician, they are the individuals or politicians who want to be either prime minister or leader of the opposition. They want to be. They're those who want to make money and those who want to get things done. The most dangerous are those who want to be.
But is there money to be made in being prime minister or leader
of the
opposition?
Well, I'm talking about the old time talk about, you know, the
corruption.
The corruption, you know.
So, Sir James, we are actually saying there are people in the Caribbean, in politics, who are in there to take advantage of situations for personal gain?
I am not saying, I'm not casting any aspersions on anyone in office today. But I am saying that there are claims like that, and of course people have to protect their reputations. I am still involved after 12 years in a commission of inquiry where they have found nothing, you know.
And that is one of the things that has happened right here in Grenada. We've had a commission of inquiry against the former prime minister in a matter where he purportedly, nothing has been proven. So the fact that nothing has been proven, shouldn't this put to bed any perceptions of corruption among these politicians?
Our judicial system we must respect. A person is always innocent until evidence is brought before his countrymen and women to say he is guilty. And it is shameful sometimes with this talk of corruption. Today, you know, the world has changed. It's not what it was a long time ago. The moment you put money into the bank, in any account, 2 years ago, I transferred money from one of my accounts in one bank to my account in another bank, and the bank asked me where they see the money, where I get this money. I said, from myself. It's not your responsibility if I transfer funds inside St. Vincent to another bank in St. Vincent. The responsibility is on the first bank, and that is how I know systems work. We have to be very careful about institutional building in the Caribbean.
But we have seen a collapse in financial institutions in the Caribbean. Right now, BICO is trying to pay back millions of dollars to depositors who have lost. BICO would probably have some background information on how BICO was set up and the regulations which were or were not put in place to govern this institution.
I blame the governor of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago and the governor of the Central Bank of the Eastern Caribbean. They are saying, at least Dwight Venner, he is saying that the Central Bank has no authority over insurance organizations. But to me, that is hiding from the issue. I know the rules of our central bank. deal with issuing certificates of deposit. When you are operating in a country and issuing certificates of deposit, you are involved in banking. And the Central Bank of the Eastern Caribbean, in since can't say they didn't know what was happening. Because every day, they have the agents in all of these islands. Every day, the agent has to report on the transfers of money between banks. You want to tell me, you see millions pouring out of St. Kitts, where you're based, Antigua, all the way down the line to Grenada and St. Vincent and the Grenadines, in various amounts. And you're not going to ask yourself a question about that and see to it that if the tools of the institution are inadequate, that you do not come before the governments and say, we want to amend these laws. We've been there before, and that is sad. And it is terrible. And I am delighted that Trinidad is making amends, because all the money paid to all these people now in the islands are going to spend it again in the islands, especially now around Christmas. They will spend it to buy fridges, they will spend it to buy clothes for the children, they will spend it for school clothes and school books and so on.
But that is
all
Trinidad.
Of that is very good.
That's a weakness on the part of Trinidad and Tobago, but what about the weakness on the part of the OECS and our central bank, which did not see the red flag going up as far as BICO, CLICO, the central bank, and all the governments that are now involved in trying to solve this mess?
I think Dwayne Venner should be ashamed of himself and he should resign. He's been there too long. I'm sure he's over 65. It's time for somebody else to take over the central bank. Somebody should pay a price. That's the way I see it. But Venner boasts that he is the longest serving central bank governor in the world.
Is that something to be proud of?
Not if you have something like this on your doorstep. You see, come back to, it's not only politicians who want to be in power.
Is it because our societies are so small and the pool of people who may want these jobs are so small that we have people who rise up and stay there for extended periods? Or are there other issues we need to be looking at in rotating these leaders?
We need to broaden opportunity, to be more inclusive, to expand opportunity for citizens. We have lots of people with ability, but a lot of people at the hierarchy are blocking those to come forward. I respect experience, and experience should move on to be used, you know? But that is important.
But part of building institutions, Sir James, wouldn't you say, is building succession as well? Everybody should understand the moment they become a leader that they're not there for life. Shouldn't this succession be built into institutions, politics, banking, you name it?
Well, it will evolve. It will evolve. And history will show the way, you know? I mean, take the position here in Grenada. Dr. Keith Mitchell, when he lost, he offered to resign from his party. They said no. He's still there. He's there with all his experience to come back. And I am sure that, and I've had discussions with Keith, and he is very much aware that he has to organize a framework of succession in his party.
And there is the experience you mentioned. You have persons like yourself, this whole council you mentioned earlier when we spoke, that has 40 people with probably 400 years of experience in dealing with political issues. Are we learning from history? You referred to Prime Minister Tillman Thomas, who is repeating some of what has happened in history. Are our experiences being used properly? Are the leaders, past leaders like yourself, helping those leaders to understand and apply history so that it will benefit?
Well, my dear Beverly, I'll tell you one thing I learned when I graduated at the University of British Columbia. My tutor said to me, Jim, you have done very well, you know? But remember to respect the opinions of others. And do not jump outside of your area of expertise, etc. When I graduated in Trinidad, at my lecturer, one day I was boasting and saying that I wanted $1,000 a month when I left this place. And the lecturer said to me, "In agriculture, young man, you're only qualified for that kind of money after you have lost a crop by drought, by flood, by pest, by disease, by earthquake, by volcano. When you have lost and you still want to farm and plant from year to year, you will be worth more than $1,000. I said, "But you're supposed to have taught us everything." He said, "No. It's a word called experience. And it's only experience will tell you the importance of experience."
So are we doomed to continue making the same mistakes?
No, well, you see, we don't seem to want to not only learn from experience, to learn from the body of knowledge that is really there in the world. How many people really read a book after they left school? How many people buy a book? How many people are inquisitive? And how we have too much saying, "Forget about that, this is my time." Don't worry with that. This is my time. You too will pass away.
We're speaking here with Sir James Mitchell, former Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. We take a short break and then we'll continue our discussion with Sir James.
Watch, talk, click, let's go. Be entertained with Flow. Watch movies together.
Flow Cable TV.
This Christmas, call your family with Flow Phone.
Best prices around.
They got the fastest broadband for your home.
And business too.
Come Flow with us this Christmas.
Flow with us this Christmas and win big. Sign up for any Flow service for your chance to win fantastic weekly prizes and a grand prize of the ultimate entertainment center. Plus, get free installation and a free token when you sign up for two or more Flow services while stocks last. Customers who pay their bill in full by the due date will also be eligible for the grand prize. Promotion ends December 24th. See press for details.
And you will see a very special Christmas.
Christmas will be.
Flow, watch, talk, click.
Grenada, you are being watched by the hardest hitting commentary team ever assembled, and they tell you as they see it every Monday at 8 p.m. on Community Channel 6. Watchdog.
Biting commentary.
A biting commentary. Repeat broadcast Saturdays at 8 p.m.
Biting commentary.
Let your crayons flow this Christmas for a chance to win one of two bicycles from Flow and Discovery Kids. Simply color the Doki activity sheet, complete the contact details, and enter your form at any Flow, Binance Miners, or Cathwell stationery location for a chance to win. 10 lucky winners will also receive a consolation prize of a $50 voucher from Cathwell stationery or Binance Miners. Must be between the ages of 2 to 10 to participate. Contest closes December 31st. Red, green, blue, pick the color for you. Who will color Doki the best?
Welcome back, viewers. Sir James, before we went on that break, we were talking about learning from experience. And one of the issues that affect the region, which we don't seem to be learning from experience, is with air travel. Liat continues to give us grief, and we don't see other airlines evolving to pick up some of the slack. What would you say about regional travel and how the governments of today can make it better?
Well, I have a quote in my book, Beyond the Islands, which I got from a Barbadian who was involved in aviation. And he said, "Liat is living proof of resurrection." When I was in government, and we were trying to reorganize Caribbean Airlines and do some privatization and involve the private sector and the foreign private sector and so on. to prepare it, Liat for privatization. All of the islands wrote off Liat debts to the Caribbean Development Bank. The Caribbean Development Bank likes to lend money to regional institutions, but they don't care. They sit down up there like a bunch of bureaucrats. It's their job, it's not their business if the thing collapses. So I know in St. Vincent we had to write off something like about $18 to $19 million. I'm sure Grenada had to write off debts. Everybody had to write off debts. Now we're going to have to write off debts again. It's the structure of Liat is fundamentally weak. Fundamentally weak. And the fundamental weakness is government ownership and control. We talk about institutional building. I am strongly in support of giving power to the people, giving power to the citizens, and allowing the market to function. This business is saying, if not, we will die. Look, how did I come to Grenada here? I called Liat. I went there myself. I didn't use any email or Twitter or anything like that. I went to Liat myself and met the manager in St. Vincent. I said, I would like to go to Grenada. You know, this is an interview last week. I gave him a week show. I have to get to Grenada next weekend. Oh, I'm sorry. You can get to Grenada, but our flights from St. Vincent go from St. Vincent to Trinidad, spend an hour or two in Trinidad, and then back to Grenada. And to get back to St. Vincent, I can't go from St. Vincent, from Grenada to St. Vincent. I have to go via Barbados. Now, I am not blaming the manager, the workers, or all the good people that I know working on Liat. I am blaming the system. And if we don't have the courage to look at the system and go and let the private sector function, and we must have a policy in the Caribbean, Beverly, of open skies. But listen, we have a policy of open skies, you know. Barbados has open skies. Any international carrier that wants to fly to Barbados gets permission right away. Anybody who wants to fly from America to Barbados, yes. From Canada, yes. From England, yes. From France, yes. From Germany, yes. From Spain, you name it. Anybody wants to go. Open skies to the rest of the world, but inside the Caribbean, protectionism. Nonsense, it can't work. Learn from what's happening out there. Learn from our experience in the past. We have the talent of young pilots, etc., who are capable of leasing aircraft out to the States and setting up operations to give some service between the islands. And we should be creating opportunities and don't think that the mixture of before will take us from one generation to another.
But the fundamental problem seems to be funding. Liat depends on money from these islands for its operations. Somehow Liat does not seem to be earning any money of its own, but it is supposed to be a business. So where does the problem lie? Should the governments get away from Liat, pull out of Liat, and leave it to be a private operation?
Create opportunities of people to function. First of all, let Liat function in a competitive atmosphere. If it can't, the market will take place. People want to travel, and people have money.
But why didn't it work with Caribbean Airlines?
Again, protectionism. When we were trying and we had the package in the past, which we operated, we got BWIA to invest with the Caribbean private sector. You know why it collapsed? One, we had the wrong plane, and we didn't have time to adjust to get a different kind of plane. But we had presumed that we could fly from the islands to Puerto Rico and Miami, and from the islands to Guyana and Venezuela. What happened? Antigua would not allow the airline to land in Antigua and go on to Puerto Rico or Miami. Trinidad, BWA, the Manin government, engaged in predatory pricing between Barbados and Trinidad and Tobago, because the volume of people coming to the Caribbean were tourists or returning nationals into the other islands. And after the plane reached Barbados going on to Trinidad, there were at least 2/3 of the seats empty. So they put a price of $100 to go up and down between Barbados and Trinidad as predatory pricing, which made it uneconomic for the private sector. Government must establish institutions to allow the private sector and the market and for individuals to use their pericranium and develop the Caribbean.
We see Liat, a disaster. We see mistakes in the governments in Grenada, St. Vincent, Antigua, all over the region. We see the Baico-Clico affair, which is also a disaster in the region. Do you see all these issues impacting on investment in the Caribbean, telling people welcome?
Well, I think where Trinidad and Tobago has to be careful is to ensure that there is a fundamental protection of property rights. If you have confidence in a country, and a lot of people invested in these things because they had confidence in Trinidad's oil's wealth and Trinidad's management, and it destroyed private property in the Eastern Caribbean. So we have to be careful again about the system, that people will no longer be confident to start investing in share capital or putting their money into those kinds of institutions. Where are they going to put their money again now? Nova Scotia, Canadian Bank.
But putting money in the banks do not contribute to development.
Well, at least, but you're safe with your money. It's developing the country is one thing, and the individual perishing in is another.
And that is one of the issues I believe governments should be looking at. Every single island in this region needs investment. You need people to come in and help to build the country. Now, if people are putting their monies in the bank, what should governments be doing to tell people, don't put your money in the bank, invest in the country?
Well, first of all, nobody's going to follow government when they see that government don't know how to use the money anyway, and their priorities and expenditure are no good, you know. In every one of these islands, every citizen can give you an example of bad usage of government's money. I am very proud of the fact that when I was there, I ran a surplus every year.
How did you manage to do that?
Oh, because I'll tell you why, Beverly. I grew up in a family that had resources, and we made our money at sea. When my father died at sea, or vanished at sea, we had built in the Grenadines the largest wooden ship ever built in the Caribbean in the Depression years of the 30s. And my father used to sail from Beque, little island, to North America, and all the way down to Venezuela, and so on. But when my father and his boat, he disappeared at sea, the boat was found. My grandmother still had debt at one plantation with the wood that my father used to build his ship. I used to walk on a Friday afternoon with an envelope with 3 shillings to pay off my father's debt. That was my greatest lesson as a Minister of Finance. Never forgot it.
Pay your debts.
That's right.
And we see a region drowning in debt.
Indeed.
So maybe.
And we're following all the mistakes that Europe making too.
But you see, it comes back to what we talked about earlier, about people learning. People don't seem to be learning. Our governments are doing the same things the same way and expecting different results. What does this region need? I mean, when you talk about air travel, the taxes we pay to travel in this region are probably among the highest in the world.
And we also arguing with the Europeans about their taxes on travel and saying they mustn't tax the people coming to the Caribbean. But we're taxing them in all kinds of foolish ways out here. We have to be selective about taxation, you know? And this business of hiding the taxes and so on in air transport is wicked.
But governments will say they need taxes.
You need revenue, but you have to be smart about it.
Creative.
You have to be creative. For example, when I abolished inheritance taxes, I put it on the living so that people may say, rest in peace, rest quiet in Bake, die in peace. But I put the tax on the living. When you buy a property, it's 5% from the buyer and 5% from the seller. And most people, when they're selling, they're smart enough, they ain't paying the 5%, they let the buyer pay the 10%, fine. You know, and the registry can't tell whether it paid from you or this or that, etc. and so on, so that's fine. So I collected my revenue, but I slashed that because I was aware, among other things, I know particularly in my country and in the Grenadines in particular, people make their living at sea and come back and build a home. And they don't have any big load of savings to give their children to pay their dues. I hate that kind of tax. No matter how bad things are, you can do things inside your country to keep it moving. And the most important thing is confidence. Come back to a friend here, Tillman. He surely should be bright enough to know that confidence in Grenada with this kind of business is dead.
So are you suggesting that investor confidence, in addition to confidence among the populace in Grenada, it's just not there?
It is for them to speak, but I know that the climate, I know the responses that you get from certain situations that you create. Every action, I'm trained as a scientist, I'm aware, to every action there's an equal and opposite reaction. You sink here, then something else will sink to go with you. You rise, other things will rise.
Dr. Sir James, I have totally enjoyed speaking with you. I mean, some of the discussions that have come out are, they're not looking very pretty for the Caribbean. We seem to have generations to go before we learn to manage ourselves properly. We want to set up regional institutions like the CCJ. We have CARICOM there. We have all these institutions that are putting, you could have a list of, an entire alphabet list of institutions, but are they functioning? Are we really growing as a region?
Well, let's go back to the thing on taxation. I learned from my long experience as a tax, as a Minister of Finance, that the best tax is one in which you spend no money to collect it. You must not increase the size of the civil service to collect tax. Use the existing machinery and keep looking to see how you could increase tax without further expenditure, which means further tax. That's one way to go about it. All this plethora of regional institutions, all that is doing is expanding the seminar and conference industry in the Caribbean. You know, when I sit back, and you know, I recognize I made some mistakes too. You know, one of the mistakes I made was about the movement of money in the Caribbean. I was chairman of a committee dealing with aliens landholding license. And I couldn't get the others to agree, saying, we will all get rid of this alien landholding license, which will affect the movement of money, the erective movement of investment. I am sorry I didn't do it alone, and said, okay, I am ready to have freedom of movement of investment in my country. First stage of Caribbean nationals. You want to tell me that if a Grenadian wants to buy something in St. Vincent, it has to go before cabinet? 2012 is the year, you know. I mean, I belong to an international organization which we go around the world, and I can see the massive movements of structures and ideas and so on. And we're not trying to even get our house in order ready to deal with those things.
We're talking a lot about money, and I want to ask you finally, the impact of debt and fiscal deficits in the region. We touched on it a little bit before, but in the bigger picture, how are these governments in the region going to come out of this hole that they've borrowed themselves into, have borrowed all of us into?
Well, first, you have to stop the rot, you know? And we have to be careful how we look at what is happening elsewhere. There's a big argument, like in Britain, where there's fiscal responsibility, and where in America, the battle between the Democrats and the Republicans about expansion of debt and creation of employment. Employment has to grow. Here, the critical thing is tourism development. And LIAT is an impediment to tourism development. I know others will say that I'm talking nonsense, but I love democracy and the discussion. That is my position. And I think I see the way to an alternative. We have to realize deficit financing can't operate. We have debts with Venezuela, with this petrocarry business. I would strongly advise the governments, before Chavez dies, I hear he's gone back to Cuba for medical attention, get him to forgive the debt. That is one we have to do. All those who are friends of Chavez, go there and say, brother, please, in your will, write off my debt. You know? So we have to look to see where we can get that right off. But we see, one of the things where we got into debt is not running our economies in a way that will attract concessionary finance. People didn't like the discipline that came with World Bank loans. They didn't like the discipline that came with European Union loans. And there's a religion that you had to follow to get that concessionary finance. I consider it a religion because it is more passionate than going to church on the Sunday morning. Conditions precedent to disbursement. I never had problems with conditions precedent to disbursement. You know, records are there for St. Vincent. Growth every year. You know, IMF came in my time, passed verdict on me. They didn't pass verdict similarly on any other country in the Caribbean or in the world. Much to praise, little to fall. When I took over St. Vincent, we had a lot of debt with all kinds of things. Water authority in debt, this in debt, sugar industry in debt. Sugar industry had $45 million of debt accumulated in 5 years. We'd gone back into sugar. Now I'm an agronomist, among other things, so on. I called in the FAO to do a study. My fiscal people had a different tone of reference. They wanted the FAO to tell them how to improve the industry. The consultants came, and they had two terms of reference. Or at least they had one term of reference, but not endorsed by the Prime Minister. I said, I don't want any analysis about telling me how to improve this thing. you have to tell me if this thing is feasible, yes or no. And I took them, they came to my home, and I gave them a lecture for about an hour. When they met the officials came into my office the morning, I wouldn't call the names, some of them still around, and said, sir, the FAO consultant said they're going along with your terms of reference and that you have a written report. I said that.
Very good.
So it's leadership. Yep. It's leadership. You've got to decide and you've got to tell the people this is it. And you got to...
It is leadership, but which direction is the leaders going?
Well, leaders have to grow. Leaders have to educate themselves. Too many leaders around in the Caribbean, I don't know when last they read a book. They're frozen with the knowledge that they had when they left university or in school.
And you gave them copies of all yours?
Well, they can't, because the other day I was coming back home and I asked the customs to look into my bag, because they always let me free. And the customs man looked at me. He said, Sir James, is all books? I said, good. I'm glad you see. So you're reading all of those? I say, every time I travel, the bookshop is my destination. And I keep constant notes on what I ought to read. I read it now. I'm reading one now about why nations fail. Just published this year.
Certainly.
And all the questions that you ask there, right there. From history, how nations fail, from the Incas right down to today.
But our leaders may be too busy borrowing money and dismissing members at a party and having rallies and all these things to read books.
When I was prime minister, I couldn't go to sleep without reading. It's a matter of discipline. It's a matter of habit.
Thank you very much, Sir James, for speaking with us. Enjoy your time in Grenada and do come again.
Thank you.
Thank you, viewers, for staying with us for that very interesting discussion with Sir James Mitchell, a former Prime Minister of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Good evening.